Simon Atta has over 20 years of calisthenics experience. His mastery in the planche, handstand push-up, and other bodyweight skills is motivating. Learn how to train smarter and reach your strength goals with confidence. People are told to use good technique and avoid using bad technique. What does this actually mean?
So when it comes to technique, if you ask different people, you get a bit of a different answer. The way I like to define technique is using the motor pattern that will maximize performance given the specific rules of that lift. So I keep it very liberal. So if you think of something like a powerlifting squat, you would say, your hips need to descend level with or below your knees. I don't really care if your knees cave in a little bit. I don't care if your spine rounds. If you lift more weight than the other person and you fulfill the requirements of that lift, you win the competition. Your technique is sound and adequate. However, good technique will be different in different contexts. So in a training context, you might specify different requirements, different technical requirements to maximize training outcomes. So a great example is pull-ups. If your only parameters are get your chin above the bar and straighten your arms at the bottom, kipping pull-ups are a great way to maximize the number of reps you can do. So if you're in a CrossFit competition and they don't have any specification that you can't kip, kip away, you'll be able to do more reps. I could do double the reps if I kipped as if I didn't. However, if I'm trying to put tension on my muscles, I don't want to kip. It's going to demand more force from my muscles not to kip using that stricter pattern. And that's going to elicit a greater training effect that I'm trying to, that is the purpose of that training session. So good technique can mean different things in different contexts. I'm generally very liberal. Use the technique that satisfies the rules of the lift. However, in training, it might be use the motor pattern that will elicit the greatest stimulus. And when you're performing, it might just be use the technique or the motor pattern that is going to give you the best aesthetic outcome. So for example, in a handstand, good technique in the calisthenics community, circus community, gymnastics community is generally a straight line handstand. You know, a banana back is tends to be frowned upon. A banana back isn't wrong. It's not dangerous. It's just not the desired aesthetic. And if you look at handstand competitions, people talk about, oh, straight lines are more efficient. But to me, this is just dogma. Because if you look at handstand competitions, the people with the longest handstands in the world reliably arch their backs. If it was more efficient to keep a straight body, you would move to that, you would gravitate toward that technique. So I'm a big fan of a straight body handstand. I'm a big fan of nice aesthetics and, you know, pretty looking exercises. But I don't think you can define technique so rigidly and say, you know, this is always good, this is always bad. I think it's very contextual.
That is the biggest piece when it comes to the discussion regarding technique, is defining the purpose first and then fitting the answer and explanation afterwards to that. And further to that, you need to mold your specific technique to your structure. With squats, we know that if you wanted to target your quads, you take a narrow stance, toes facing relatively straight. But then if you're someone that doesn't have the hip anatomy or ankle mobility to be able to do that, your compromise might be a wider stance, toes flared out. It'll change the muscle recruitment, but the alternative is you not squatting. So you just need to be able to put it into that category as well.
Yeah, and here's a bit of a practical advice that fits with this idea is a lot of people use these prerequisites for lifts. So you know, they say you shouldn't squat until you have adequate ankle mobility to do it on the floor. You shouldn't handstand until you have 180 degrees of shoulder flexion or 90 degrees of wrist extension. That is all BS. I think one of the best ways to improve your ankle, let's say you have restricted ankle mobility and you can't squat to full depth, just elevate your heels and elevate them as little as possible that it challenges your ankle mobility. That's probably the best way to improve it. It's specific to the outcome you're trying to improve it for, and you get to practice the skill while you do it. Take the handstand. Very few people can do a perfectly straight line handstand, especially when they start. And if you look at some of the best hand balancers in the world, when they started, you know, they had restricted shoulder mobility. They spent time on their hands. It improved through that along with specific stretching. So you can still develop attributes. You can improve your motor control. You can improve your spatial awareness. You can improve your balance mechanisms in your hand while you work on those specific attributes that you lack for the straight line handstand.
That's the biggest takeaway that I've gotten from yourself and other experts in the field of, say, physiotherapy, is specificity isn't just relation to strength training, it's also to range of motion acquisition as well. You could spend all day doing all these fancy drills for your ankle, hips, etc., but nothing ticks that box of specificity like the movement itself, and just modifying your posture so that it is possible for your body is one of the biggest bang for your buck changes people can do, and really focus and channel their effort instead of having a million different prehab, warm-up exercises and stuff. They can just focus on what they actually want to improve, and that fuels that positive cycle of motivation because they're improving the exercise they want, and they're also improving the function of their body moving too.
Yeah, 100%. And you have limited resources. You have limited time to train, to learn, to practice, to recover. So you can't be amazing at everything. And I think this applies to all fields of life, but exercise as well. You know, you're not going to be a powerlifter and a bodybuilder and a marathon runner. You know, you might be a powerlifter and a bodybuilder. you're not going to be a calisthenics athlete and a, you know, triathlete and a, you can't do everything. And it's okay to have attributes that you don't train. So I think things like cardio. Cardio is great for heart health. It's great for longevity. It's great for your health. And I like to, you know, go for walks or, you know, spend a bit of time doing some cardio exercises occasionally. But it's not really something that I specifically train for. I do include a little bit to stay healthy. And people online, there tends to be this trend online recently, which is like, you neglect this thing, you must train it, right? Here's the thing you're neglecting, TIB ant raises. And TIB ant raises are all the hype right now, and people are making claims that they solve everything. But really, you don't need to train your TIB ant if you don't want to. You know, sure, it is a commonly neglected muscle, but it's also not a very important muscle for many of the exercises that we do. It may serve a bit of purpose in decelerating if you land with a heel strike. It helps your foot clear in gait, but you know, you possess the strength to do that. That's not resisted anyway. And if you don't land with a heel strike, you're not going to be using it that much. I'd much rather focus on the big rocks first, you know, focus on your quads, focus on your glutes, do those things. And then if you have some problems, you know, you have shin splints, sure, adding in things like TIB ant raises will help, but it's not something everyone needs to do. And to that point, you can say, oh, but it's an often neglected muscle. I can name another 10, you know, do you train your big toe extensors? Do you train finger extension with a band? Do you train hip internal and hip external rotation against resistance? Probably not.
Yeah, I think there's more, as you mentioned there, a place for these isolated exercises for very small muscle groups in the scheme of things when it comes to that prehab injury related sphere. And the thing is, the majority of people that are training aren't in that category. They just want to get stronger, build muscle, and or increase flexibility for the most part. And working on these little things comes back to what we just said, which it takes you away from putting effort into the big rocks that you can actually progress, putting your full energy into that. We see that in the difference with elite performers. They're not doing a ton of these accessory type of things. They're just being really calculated with their goal and working on that.
Yeah, exactly. Like if I had to ask you, what would you pick for a vertical jump? TIB ant raise or a back squat?
It's an obvious one because, yeah, for many reasons, it's the largest muscle group contributing to that movement pattern. You've got the greatest potential for progressive overload, and it's much more fun doing squats than TIB ant raises, but that's my bias coming in.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a pattern used. Like in a vertical jump, you don't need a TIB ant. You're plantar flexing.
That's true. Yeah. What about the deceleration, Simon? You've got to decelerate so that you can bounce back.
Yeah, yeah. As I said earlier, if you're running into a jump with a heel strike, your TIB ant will play a bit of a role in deceleration. But if you land with a toe strike, it won't. If you're doing a standing vertical jump, it won't. And the thing people forget is that if you're running into a vertical jump with a heel strike, your quads and your glutes are going to be doing a lot more shock absorption and a lot more decelerating. Your quads particularly rather than your tib ant. It's a bigger muscle group. It can produce more force. It can absorb more shock.
Agreed. With calisthenics, what makes it unique as a strength training discipline compared to, say, lifting weights?
So when it comes to strength, if you just define strength as the ability to produce force, that whether you lift weights or you use your body weight as resistance, it's the same thing. You're producing force. Your muscles don't really know. They don't really care what they're needing to resist and overcome. They just need to produce force to overcome it. However, these specific motor patterns that you're trying to train will be different. So, you know, if you want to get good at dips, going back to that principle of specificity, train dips. If you want to get good at bench press, train bench press. There'll be some carryover, but train the thing that you want to get good at. One thing that is very different with calisthenics is that your body weight is relatively stable and you can't adjust it. So when it comes to weights, it's very easy to overload and to manipulate the intensity. You can just add a bit of weight to the bar, take a little bit of weight off the bar. When it comes to calisthenics, you cannot take your legs off. You have to find other methods to manipulate the intensity or change how much force your muscles must produce. And the way we tend to do that in calisthenics is by manipulating leverage. So if you just think about a seesaw, if you put a kilogram weight halfway down one end, applied a force to it, it would lift up. If you moved that twice as far away, you would need to produce double the force in the same place to make that lift up. So that's the way calisthenics works. You're changing the lever arms. You're putting your muscles in a mechanically disadvantageous position relative to the weight or relative to the resistance. Whereas with weights, you tend to keep lever arms the same, keep the motor pattern the same, and just change the force or the weight.
How does body weight influence that leverage system?
So if you weigh more, I think if we come back to the seesaw, it's probably the easiest way to illustrate this point. Think about a seesaw. You put a kilogram halfway down one end. Let's say you've got a fulcrum and the kilogram is a meter from the fulcrum. To balance that, you need to produce a kilogram of downward force a meter away on the other side. Now, if you double the weight, you need to produce double the force. But if you just moved that weight twice as far from the center, you would also need to produce double the force, despite it only weighing a kilogram as well. So when it comes to body weight, the way your body weight influences calisthenic skills is that you can just think of it, you weighing more. So it doesn't really change the lever arm, but if I'm 90 kilos versus 70 kilos, you can think about that 90 kilos being 1 meter away versus 70 kilos being 1 meter away. It changes the torque at the joints and it changes the force requirements from the muscles. Yeah, so weighing more, it depends where your weight is distributed. Weighing more in calisthenics is generally harder.
And that's why I wanted to ask about the impact of more weight being distributed towards the legs. Is this potentially a factor and why some calisthenics athletes do or don't train legs?
Yeah, so if you think of a skill, think of any leverage skill, like the planche, the lever, the human flag, take your pick. If you, if you're very top heavy and all your weight is, pecs and lats and you have no legs, your weight is going to be distributed very close to the shoulder joint. So if you think of a planche, these are my arms, this is my body. This won't balance because my center of mass, my weight is somewhere around my hips. Now to balance it, I need to lean forward to get my center of weight over the hands. If my weight is distributed, here at my hips, I need to lean this much. If my weight is distributed up here because I'm all lats and no legs, I don't need to lean as far to balance that weight. If my weight was all at my legs, I would need to lean a lot further, which changes the force requirements because it changes that lever arm.
Okay, that makes sense.
If you want to demonstrate this point practically without getting into the physics of torque, you can just put ankle weights on. Just put ankle weights. So just do a planche or a flag, whichever skill you can do. And if you can't do a planche with a band. And then do, or hold an L-sit and put some ankle weights on your thighs. And you'll see, okay, that's pretty hard. Now move those ankle weights to your knees and then move those ankle weights to your toes. And you'll see just how much harder it becomes. That's the equivalent of adding mass in any of those areas.
That's so interesting because we can all relate to gaining a kilo or two of just body weight and how it feels to just walk around, go upstairs. You can really notice that increased weight. If you put that towards the distal part of your body, being the legs, with what we understand with body weight leverages, it really does make sense why it can make a significant change on performance and progress too.
Yeah, yeah. And if you think of, you see this in weights as well. If you take weighted exercises that have long lever arms, small changes make a huge difference. So like if you think of something with a relatively short lever arm, think of your shoulder press, where the lever arm is from your, you know, your shoulder to your elbow with my weight, with the weight directly over it. You know, I can add pretty significant weight and not really feel a difference. I can throw 1 or 2 kilos on and, you know, not really feel a big change in the intensity. If I do a lateral raise instead, where the lever arm is double, and I add 1 or 2 kilos to my lateral raise, it just quickly becomes impossible. I can take a weight I can do, add 2 kilos to it, and all of a sudden I can barely do any reps. And that just shows you the significance of long lever arms.
Now that we understand that, when it comes to measuring your progress, what's the best way to do this to stay motivated with calisthenics, given that we're changing leverages for those type of exercises?
Yeah, I think just find something that you can replicate, find a position that you can replicate or an exercise that you can replicate, and just see if your number of reps or your hold time increases. So for example, a tuck planche is very easy to replicate. You just tuck your legs maximally, set some basic standards like straight arms, hips and shoulders level, and test your max hold time. It might be 10 seconds. If you increase that to 20 seconds, you can be pretty confident you've gotten stronger. Your capacity of that exercise has doubled. I would just do it the same way that you do with weights. Pick an exercise, let's say the bench press, set some basic parameters, chest touches your bar, arms straighten at the top. How many reps can you do? If you've increased some reps, you've increased the weight, fantastic, you've gotten stronger. Same thing with calisthenics. If I can hold a tuck lever, or I can do tuck lever raises, how many reps can I do? How long can I hold it? When that increases, I can be fairly confident I've gotten stronger. Or you can then test a more challenging position, such as the advanced tuck, the single leg, the full, and see what your max hold time is there. So it's the same thing with weights. If your number of reps go up, you are, you know, relatively stronger. Your strength endurance has increased with that given weight. And when your reps go up, so generally does your capacity to lift something once. So your one rep max will generally go up as well. And you can easily test that in calisthenics or with weights.
Yeah, it's a bit trickier with calisthenics measuring one repetition max. It's more of a extrapolation from a hold time. Could you explain that? Because it's not like you're doing one rep.
Yeah, so when it comes to calisthenics, the difference there is you have isometric exercises that you also have available in weights, but nobody does them. So, you know, people might do some wall sits or, you know, hold a like lateral raise, but people generally aren't testing with those exercises. Those aren't the meaningful things that you're trying to get stronger. Calisthenics is a little bit different because you do have repetition-based exercises. So you could, for example, dips for a beginner. For an advanced athlete, it might be 90-degree push-ups. That's easy to test a one rep max. Keep your body straight, down to 90 degrees, back up. You can do that in a straddle position or a full position if you want. You know, planche push-ups, lever raises, those are all repetition-based exercises that you would test in the same way as weights. Just how many reps can I do at a given intensity? The difference that calisthenics, something that's a bit unique to calisthenics, is we have meaningful static exercises. You know, we care about how long can I hold a planche? How long can I hold a front lever? How long can I hold a human flag? And testing your one rep max equivalent with that is a little bit difficult, because if you just set a hold time of 1 second, it's very hard to know if you actually held it. You know, you could just kind of pass through the position, get there, is that 1 second? So instead, I usually set a little bit of a longer duration so I can be pretty confident that I can hold the position. So, you know, what's the hardest position you can hold for about 3 seconds? And if you think of a one rep max, that's often about how long the concentric phase of one rep max will take. So what's the hardest shape you can hold for 3 seconds, 5 seconds, 8 seconds? Those are all probably equivalents of what's your one rep max, 3 rep max, 5 rep max.
Makes sense. And just standardizing and having repeatability of the exact posture, progression you were in, and also time as a point of comparison. Because I believe from seeing people doing calisthenics, there tends to be more of like a random approach to it, more of like a play and just, oh, maybe this time I'll test on rings, or this time I'll test it on the floor, or this time on the parallettes. You can't accurately compare and contrast if the environment isn't similar. So just setting that for yourself and having, I guess, like a history of tests over the years would be a good recommendation for people, so you can see how you stack up over time on the different conditions.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's the same thing with weights, but I think it's a little bit more intuitive with weights. Like people do a bench press and they don't compare that to their dumbbell bench press. You know, they don't say, I can do 100 on the bench, but I can only do 40 with dumbbells. Why, you know, did I get weaker? No, it's just a harder exercise. You can't lift as much weight. And you see similar things with calisthenics, but it often takes people a little bit longer to kind of understand that.
Exactly.
If you want a clear, if you want a really clear way to paint that picture, try your max dips and then try your max dips on rings, and you'll probably notice you cannot do nearly as many.
That's a great example, especially if you hadn't had a training phase of familiarizing yourself with the movement pattern. It's going to be a stark contrast, those two. For strength skills, how does frequency come into play with making progress and getting stronger?
When people define strength skills, I think of this as a continuum of continuum of kind of technical requirements. So ultimately, everything is a skill. A bicep curl is a skill, but it is much less skill heavy or much less technically demanding than a handstand push-up or a pistol squat. So the thing we need to consider there is the technical demand of the exercise. How challenging is it to coordinate the movement pattern? And how familiar are you with that movement pattern? So if you tested with something like take your least skillful strength test, isometric knee extension. Okay, so isometric knee extension against a dynamometer to measure how much force you can produce. For that movement, I would just build muscle. You know, I would do leg extensions, I would do squats. I would maybe include some practice of that movement, you know, just like isometric knee extension as forcefully as I could to practice that specific skill. But I'm already pretty good at it. Most people can contract a muscle maximally at a single joint very easily. You know, without much practice, you're already a master of that movement. Whereas something like a squat, it takes a lot more practice to get good at that movement pattern. So if you take someone who's never squatted before and get them to try a squat, it kind of looks all over the place. It's janky. It's kind of looks like they're going to lose balance. They don't know how to coordinate it properly. But with practice, they can improve really quickly. Because a lot of that is just being familiar with the movement, being able to integrate that motor pattern more efficiently, and just getting familiar with it. It's neurological changes rather than structural changes to your muscles getting bigger and stronger. So for something like a squat, it takes a lot of practice to master that movement pattern. Now, squatting is like about as technical as powerlifting gets. But if you go to calisthenics, it becomes a lot more technical. A handstand push-up is much harder to do. If you ask anyone on the street, can you show me a squat? They can fulfill the requirements of that lift, even though it might be sloppy. For a handstand push-up, they just can't. You know, not many people can balance a handstand, let alone coordinate the movement pattern of lowering down, lifting up, and pressing their body weight. So when it comes to skills that require a lot more fine motor control, a lot more balance, a lot more of what we call like a skill component, a lot more of a technical demand, motor control demand, I think high frequency training is really beneficial. Because if you want to learn an instrument, right, your best way to do that is just do plenty of practice, kind of reinforce that motor pattern, reinforce that skill. When I say skill from this point on, it will generally refer to motor control, you know, of the thing that you're trying to do. So you want to get good at shooting a basketball, you don't practice once a week, you practice every day. You do lots of high quality practice, shy of fatigue, lots of reps of it to get better at that pattern. If you want to get good at a squat, you do lots of high quality reps, shy of fatigue. You're not trying to push to failure, you're trying to uphold a good quality of movement. So when it comes to developing the skill of things like handstand pushups, 90-degree pushups, muscle ups, I think high frequency practice is really, really beneficial to kind of master that movement pattern. Once you've got the movement pattern, once you've kind of mastered the movement pattern, it just relies a lot more on just like stacking on muscle. Once you've kind of hit a ceiling for that to improve further, what you'll often see is you make these kind of like beginner gains, and then you kind of plateau once you've kind of mastered these movement patterns. You need to make some more structural changes to advance. So when you look at muscle mass correlates correlates with strength, but it's not perfect. And that's because there are other components involved, you know, and there is a neurological component as well. But when you take elite lifters in any category, so take elite power lifters, muscle mass correlates a lot more than for beginners. And the reason is, in beginners, I think you have so much variation in the neurological ability. You know, someone might have the structural, they might have enough muscle mass in their quads and glutes to squat a lot of weight, but they just suck at that motor pattern. They're not familiar with it. Whereas once you get to the elite level, everyone has refined that motor pattern. They've practiced it so much. They're at a ceiling for neural efficiency. And that's why performance correlates a lot better with muscle mass, because it's simply everyone's a master of the movement. It's the people that can accrue the most muscle that become the best lifters.
I remember seeing a study on powerlifting, or it might have been an interpretation of the world records for every weight class, and they could, without seeing the person lift, they could determine that the ones that were higher tended to have more muscle mass to be able to get the score. So you can almost know someone's total by knowing their muscle mass. Lower total, less muscle mass. Higher total, more muscle mass in the constraints of the weight class. It's really interesting.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense to me, because when you have an elite population, you've kind of selected for all those other things that vary a lot. So, you know, all the elite lifters, the people who continue with weightlifting for years, are probably the ones who were kind of naturally pretty good at it. They had good tendon insertions for it, good limb segment lengths for it. We're just naturally strong people. Their muscles produce a lot of force. So all of those things are kind of balanced in that population already. And then over 10 years, everyone's mastered the squat. They've mastered the deadlift. They've mastered whatever the lift is technically. And then it just comes down to who can accrue the most muscle ultimately. That's why it correlates so well. You know, there obviously are other variables that contribute, but you've kind of neutralized those with just the selection process that everyone has good variables already.
So given the handstand push-up, strength skill, a lot of complexity, we understand that a higher frequency approach is advantageous to get better at the movement pattern. Whereabouts on that spectrum in higher frequency, what would that look like practically? How many days per week, for example?
Like most things, I don't think it's a black and white answer, but the way I would approach it is just look at where your deficit lies. So if you find somebody who's a master at the handstand push-up, they've done it for 10 years and they just fail due to force output. They never lose balance. The motor pattern's refined. They can do it every time. They just can't push enough. For them, I don't think they need a high frequency. You know, they've mastered the movement pattern. They don't fall over. They just need enough to kind of maintain their technical proficiency. And they just need to build more muscle mass. Do some overhead press. You could get away with training twice a week, you know, doing hard shoulder sessions twice a week. That person would probably make great gains. For the person who is a beginner and they can balance a handstand, I think this will be relevant to a lot of your audience. You can balance a handstand. You can get, you know, one handstand push-up, maybe three sometimes, but it's very inconsistent and you often fail because you fall over. It's not, I just come down and I can't push, but I never fall. It's sometimes I get up, sometimes I get two, sometimes I get lucky and I get four, but very often I kick up and I just lose balance on the way down. For them, it's not the force output requirement that is limiting them. They can produce enough force at each constituent joint. They just can't integrate it into a motor pattern consistently to execute that outcome. For them, rather than pushing every set to failure, where you're inducing a lot of fatigue, your motor pattern gets sloppier, I would stay shy of failure and I would do lots of high quality reps very frequently. So maybe every day or every second day, ideally every day, if you can recover from it, just do a few high quality handstand pushups, shy of failure. Shy of failure will mean you don't induce as much fatigue, means you can train every day, and it will mean your motor pattern is cleaner. and you're eliciting the desired outcome. When you practice a skill, you want it to be, you know, you want it to be good quality attempts. When you shoot a basketball, you want to get the ball in or come close to it. You don't just want to shoot aimlessly at the ring. Same thing with handstand pushups. If you want to get better at the skill or the technique of it, lots of high quality reps shy of failure. Come down, focus on balancing it, controlling it through range, slow speed of movement, pushing up, holding the handstand at the top, controlling it through range. That will address the skill component of the exercise. And then maybe twice a week, you throw in some heavy pike pushups, some wall reps to elicit the structural changes to your muscle, which are also important in strength. So, you know, lots of high quality reps every day, very frequently, and then things to failure less frequently to induce those structural changes.
That is world-class advice there, because I believe most people would be doing the standard 2 to 3 pushing workouts a week on average. And when you compare that to someone that's doing handstand pushups 5, 6, 7 days a week, the rate of progress in skill acquisition will be absolutely night and day. But the difference is the mindset, which you explained there, is the training intensity is short of fatigue. This auto-regulation becomes such an important factor, and that will change day to day. You can't be like, I'm going to do 10 handstand pushups every single day. One of the days you can do 10 fine, but then you get to the second or third day and you're really struggling, like 7, 8 of those reps are not clean or unsuccessful. That's where you need to really auto-regulate based on the day and change the mindset.
Yeah, and the example of the person training 7 days a week doing handstand and handstand push-up practice, and then doing 2 days a week of shoulder strength training to failure, they might program that by doing 3 days of high frequency, shy of failure, handstand push-up work. And then on the third day, after that skill work, they push their muscles to failure. The next day they might rest because they're just too fried to do high quality handstand push-ups the next day. They reduce their training frequency to 5 days.
As a consequence of their lack of fatigue management.
Yeah.
I was going to give a personal example there. I found for myself personally, just getting stronger overhead was the biggest catalyst to improving my freestanding handstand push-up. I found that I could only do, say, for example, 5 deficit handstand push-ups chest to wall. And then when I'd go to freestanding with the intention of trying to do, say, 3 to 5 reps, I was getting bottlenecked by a lack of force output. And I believe this is a situation that many people doing calisthenics face. And the simple thing is you just got to get strong and improve that force output. If you can do 15 handstand push-ups against the wall, 5 freestanding, given you practice the movement, it's going to come so much easier than someone that can do 5 handstand push-ups against the wall, trying to do 5 handstand push-ups freestanding.
Exactly. And in your case, you weren't limited by skill. You know, you could do 5 against a wall. You could do 3 to 5 freestanding. And you're not falling over. You're just getting stuck at the bottom by your inability to produce force. In that case, doing lots of skill work, doing lots of singles, greasing the groove is not going to pay as good dividends as doing work closer to failure, eliciting changes in your muscle, being able to produce more force at the constituent joints.
Let's contrast that now with the other side of strength for isometrics. Given that these aren't as technical, would it be fair to say that you could get away with a lower frequency, high intensity approach?
You could. I still think that isometrics are fairly technical. I don't think they're as technical as something like a handstand push-up, but I think if you're just training planche or front lever once a week, I think the motor pattern is going to be pretty rusty. And over the long term, I think building muscle mass is, a key component there. But in the short term, if you want to see short-term gains, if you want to peak for something, I think you should be including a little bit more high-frequency practice. I think a good way to kind of get the best of both worlds is to, train the meaningful skills to you at least a few times a week. So, 2 to 3 times is a minimum. And I would say that for most meaningful exercises, whether it's a squat, a bench press, a planche, or a front lever, train it a few times a week to keep the motor pattern fresh. And you can do kind of longer duration holds to practice that motor pattern, to push your muscles to failure. And then once or twice a week when you're fresh, just do some higher intensity stuff. And that's a good way to just build strength year round. So like take bench press, for example. If you're doing sets of 10 most of the time, great. You'll build some muscle mass. Your strength will improve over time. If you really want to ensure that skill of lifting heavy weight is there, you know, you want to practice the skill of a 1RM or you want to practice the skill of a high intensity planche hold, include one or two attempts a week at a higher intensity. So you might just do a double at 90% or a single at 90% once or twice a week. Same thing with a planche. You might just do a 5-second hold at your, you know, 6-second hold max once a week.
That balanced approach is probably the biggest lesson that I've learned from you, Simon. You don't have to pick, okay, now I'm just trying to get strong or now I'm just trying to build muscle, because that works really well in the short term if you want to absolutely prioritize that. But I guess for most people, a lot of satisfaction comes from the mix, building some mass, getting stronger. And there's so many like side, like almost intangible benefits to the variance of, say, intensity. It's psychologically easier to come and do a moderate hold compared to like a few short duration ones. It's probably more joint sparing if you're doing more aggressive type of exercises, to split it between a moderate intensity and a high intensity. And we can just go on and on with that. And the enjoyment piece comes into it too, because you've got something different to look forward to in each of those similar sessions. You could be doing your planche, say, 3 times a week, and you could be alternating between the different intensities within those. It keeps it fun.
Yeah, yeah. And there's plenty of ways to kind of achieve the same outcome. You could do like, you could come in and just do a low intensity day where you do 30 second holds and then do a high intensity day where you do 5 to 10 second holds. Or you could start your session with the high intensity holds and finish it with the low intensity holds, like doing back off sets in powerlifting. And if your kind of intensity and intensity, volume and quality of training is matched, you should get a similar outcome regardless of how you distribute that.
It's great. And also just testing your maximum attempt in the different strength skills is motivating, because you don't deprive yourself of waiting for 12 weeks to deload and then assess where your strength is. By just doing a random attempt like once a week, every couple of weeks, I could see how that'd be a real driver to like continue with your plan, because you can see the adaptation more immediately.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that the difference there, I think one reason it's like a bit more of a psychological reward in calisthenics is that in weightlifting, whether you can bench press 100 kilos or 120 kilos, it's the same movement. It's a bench press. Whereas in calisthenics, when you progress, you unlock a new skill. So a tuck planche and a straddle planche are just different progressions of the same exercise. But when you unlock a straddle planche, when you first get your straddle planche push up or your first straddle planche hold, you feel like you've achieved a new element. And you just kind of have. It's a new body position. It's not the exact same movement with extra weight.
This episode is sponsored by FitnessFAQs. Become a bodyweight beast with our calisthenics workouts. Use the coupon code PODCAST10 at checkout to save 10% off when shopping at fitnessfaqs.com. Don't miss this discount. Start training smarter and enjoy the gains. Can you give me some practical weekly guidelines for intensity and what that'd look like in terms of isometric holds, rep ranges, given we discussed the high intensity, low intensity? What does that mean in calisthenics?
Yeah, so think about the outcome that you want to achieve. If you just want to build muscle, you can do so with a range of intensities. And I would just tell you to train with whatever you like and kind of add some variation if you want to. But if you want to get strong for calisthenics, you want to hold challenging postures, you want to do hard skills, you want to do 90 degree push-ups, one-arm chin-ups, and hold a front lever. Those require a lot of force output. The more force you can produce, the better. And specificity is key. If you want to get good at doing those things, once again, let's just use the parallel of our weightlifting, because it's all the same principles. So whether your goal is high intensity planche holds, 90 degree push-ups, handstand push-ups, you know, one to three rep maxes and 5 to 8 second holds at your highest intensity, or your goal is a squat 1RM, a bench 1RM, a deadlift 1RM, it's kind of the same principles. You want to train specifically to the outcome. If you want to get good at lifting heavy weights once, you need to be lifting heavy weights. If you look at that repetition continuum, if you train low reps, you get good at low reps. You get good at heavy, high force output stuff. If you train high reps, you can still build muscle, but you get better at that strength endurance stuff. You get kind of different adaptations. The problem with only doing one rep maxes is that it is very hard to accrue muscle over the long term. So if you said, hey, I've got a powerlifting comp or I've got a planche comp in 4 weeks, how can I get better at it? I'd be like, do a ton of one rep attempts, you know, do lots of heavy stuff. You'll get lots of neurological changes that will work really well in the short term. But if you draw that out to 3 years and you said, hey, I want to get good at my, I've got a planche comp in 3 years. And I said, do one rep maxes. That is not going to give you the best bang for your buck over a long time frame. So people say things like, you know, heavy weights is great for strength and light weights is great for endurance. And that is true. But studies that measure this tend to be 6 to 12 weeks long. They don't tend to be years in duration.
Yeah.
And the problem with only doing one rep maxes is that at a certain intensity, at a certain high enough intensity, let's say below 5 reps or definitely 1 rep, you are not going to accrue as much muscle. And as we spoke about earlier, muscle mass is a key component of your performance in the long term. So instead of just doing one rep maxes, I think it is very important to do some high intensity work, you know, maybe in the 3 to 5 rep range or in the 5 to 10 second hold range. However, that should also be accompanied with some lower repetition or higher repetition or higher hold duration training to challenge your muscles enough, accumulate enough volume to stimulate structural changes. So what I would do when it comes to intensity, I would include a combination of higher and lower intensities, do a couple of attempts or a couple of sets at a high intensity once or twice a week, maybe 2 to 3 sets of 5 to 10 second holds, or maybe 2 to 3 doubles or triples. And then I would also accompany that with some higher repetition range work. So 15 to 30 second holds when it comes to isometrics, or maybe 8 to 15 reps when it comes to repetition-based exercises. And there are so many ways to do this. You could do it with different exercises. Like you could, if you're a powerlifter, you might come in and you might do your heavy sets with squats. You might do like 4 sets of triples, or you might do a 5x5. And then you might do back off sets with the same exercise or different exercises, Bulgarian split squats, RDLs, things like that, that will help with the exercise, even though it's a different movement. Same thing with calisthenics. Do high intensity work with the stuff that's meaningful to you. Do some lighter sets with similar exercises. Let's say it's planche, you might do unassisted holds. Then you might do longer duration band assisted holds, or you might do longer duration holds at a lower intensity, or you might do pseudo planche pushups for the higher repetition stuff.
A few things to add just to close off what you said. The doing just one rep max or anything less than 3 reps for the majority of your training would be a really inefficient way to go about doing things. Fantastic if you're a month away from a competition and you want to maximize your performance in that. You're not doing any accessories. You're just doing these high intensity specific stuff. Great. But for year-long training, it's just so much more reasonable to be doing sets of 3 to 5 for your strength, for 3 sets, resting 3 minutes plus if you need it, just to be able to get in more practice as well in the movement pattern at a still high enough intensity to be able to build strength. And then additionally to this, when you want to finish your session with some more moderate rep stuff to build muscle mass, you don't have to do it obviously on the same exercise that you just did. You're just trying to just build muscle in those prime movers that are involved in the compound exercise. So use the planche, whatever you're doing for a high intensity, say 3 to 5 reps or short holds of say 5 to 10 seconds. You could follow that up with your dips as well as your handstand push-ups against the wall. They're not technical in those respects, and you build muscle in your chest, shoulders, triceps that can then be taught in that main movement when you return to it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, your ability to perform on any strength task is the product of your structure and your neurological ability. So your muscles are what produce force at the constituent joints, and you need to be able to recruit those efficiently and in the correct motor pattern for the desired outcome. All else being equal, a bigger muscle is a stronger muscle. So practice the skill itself to get good at that motor pattern, and then do things that challenge those muscles to build muscle mass.
Could you just bring this home with training to failure? Because we get people in the world of calisthenics who just quote unquote train to failure all day, every exercise. That's the best way to know that you're training hard enough versus people that are more calculated and include failure more sparingly. Where would this feature in addition to what you just said before?
Training to failure is a bit contentious. I don't think you have a black and white answer. And if you ask experts in the field that study this, you will get a lot of we don't know and a lot of this is, you know, what I think and what I suspect, but it's really not too clear. So when it comes to on a per set basis, building muscle mass, training to failure does seem to produce superior results per set. And what you see is that going closer to failure, you get more muscle growth, and you hit a point of kind of non-linearity where you get more muscle growth toward the very end of the set. So those last one or two reps kind of do give you more bang for your buck. However, training to failure is also more fatiguing, and this will limit how much volume you can do. So while it's true that on a per set basis, training to failure will give you more muscle mass, that might not apply over 20 sets because your quality of sets will be worse. You will induce more fatigue and you might not be able to accrue as much volume. It might be more stimulative on a per set basis, but ultimately you can just get more stimulus by adding sets and get more practice of the movement. So when it comes to training to failure, I think training to failure is a great thing. I think you should train close to failure, take some sets to failure, so you kind of know what hard training feels like and know what your ability is, but you don't need to train to failure. And if you're training the skill stuff, stay shy of failure. If you're training strength stuff, you know, make sure that it is somewhat challenging. But there's not really a black and white answer about you must or you must not train to failure. What I tend to do is I encourage beginners to train to failure just to kind of build character and get a feeling of what going to failure feels like. You know, test your limits. What can you get to? Make sure you are at least doing that or going close to that. Because there is a lot of evidence that people, if you just give them like, hey, train how you normally train in the gym, and you ask them to push to failure, they're normally doing like half the number of reps that they could actually do. And that's not very effective training. So as a beginner, train to failure, know what training to failure is like. If you're someone who tends to be slack, train to failure. That would be my advice to you, just to make sure that you're training hard. If you're someone who pushes really hard and loves training and is always in the gym and things hurt, you're always sore, maybe just back off a bit, take sets a bit further from failure. And one time I would encourage you to take sets further from failure is if your performance really deteriorates within a session. So let's say you start with planche, and then you do planche push-ups as your second exercise. And after you've done planche holds to failure, your planche push-ups just suck because you're so fatigued. In that case, just train your planche push-ups a little bit lighter. So stop, you know, with a few more seconds in reserve so that you induce less fatigue and that you can uphold better performance on the later sets. This way you can include a combination of both. You might do your first three sets of an exercise shy of failure and your last one to failure. Or you might do your first exercises shy of failure and your subsequent exercises to failure. Plenty of ways to do it and achieve similar outcomes.
For sure. Or even like the final set, going closer towards that failure, touching it or even going towards it has value, especially if you're doing a split that has like a pushing exercise, a pulling exercise, a leg exercise. That'd be room where it wouldn't impede your session as much. And also it's very exercise specific too. You wouldn't be going to failure on, as you said, highly complex strength skill movements like squats, where there's much more injury risk and there's a point of diminishing returns for actually doing that anyway. But I wouldn't be afraid later in the session, if you're doing stuff more for say hypertrophy and you're doing things on a machine, you're finishing with a final compound exercise on a machine, the injury risk is really low for going to failure because of the external stability that's afforded to you by the machine. It's just, you're not really going to have many issues if you do it in that environment. And then also, like, how fatigued are you really going to get from certain isolation exercises taken to failure or even beyond? Because we know with a lot of exercises, say a bicep curl, an incline bicep curl, if you're stopping when you can no longer complete the full range of motion, you are arguably leaving some in the tank for bicep growth by not just doing a couple of stretch-mediated hypertrophy reps at the end there. So it's, as you said at the start, it's a very nuanced topic of failure, and the whole it depends rings extremely true for this. And this is just the joy of training and just learning your body, because even without reading this or watching videos about it, people intuitively understand this. It's like, I'm making more progress if I fail later in the session compared to the start, or I only fail on my isolation movements, and I'm getting great results. So listen to your body, experiment with different things, and you'll find what's great given your workout structure, exercises, etc.
Yeah. What you'll find is when you start, you often want the perfect program. And should I be doing 3 sets of 5 or 3 sets of 7 or 4 sets of 6? What's the perfect program? Is this exercise better than that exercise? And the more you learn, it probably doesn't matter. There are just some kind of very important principles that everyone adheres to, like training hard and training specifically. And if you have those in check, you'll probably make progress.
Why do you believe there's such a debate online with what is considered optimal?
I think it's just the human desire for kind of like wanting the secret.
Certainty.
I think there are a few things there. I think there's an incentive for influencers to tell you this, like, this is the best exercise because I want to sell a program and make money, which is just simply not true. I think there's also just the human desire to get an outcome in the easiest way. So it's like, you know, like if you said, how can I get rich? And somebody's like, work really hard and make smart investment decisions. Like, come on, tell me the secret. You know,
That's the wrong answer.
Yeah, there you go. Well, there's work involved there. But people want to get rich quick scheme, and, you know, people want this one fad diet that's going to, you know, work. People want to get there without putting in the work, or they want, you know, even if they are willing to do the work, they want the quickest path to the outcome. They want certainty. Unfortunately, training doesn't work like that. It's very hard to say how you're going to respond to something. There often is no best program. And even if you gave two different people the same program, you would get different outcomes despite them putting in just as much effort. So there's a lot of uncertainty in training, and there are really just some big overarching principles that we should adhere to that tend to work very well on average.
What's difficult is trying to make guidelines as, say, influencers or exercise professionals when we know deep down the individual factors are so big. It's like a program that worked for you when you were 20, where you had no major life commitments, you're at your hormonal prime, you're relatively new to these exercises, they work until they don't. And then it's over time, as you age or you've become familiar with an exercise, it becomes stale. So what was once optimal through switching it out, if we say you've been doing parallel bar dips for so, so long, you're stalling, that would have been optimal for you for a long time. But then if you want something novel and different to challenge the same movement pattern, a ring dip could be optimal for a short period of time until it's not.
Yeah. Or if you just take something like your stress and diet, let's say 30 sets per week of squats is optimal for you. 30 sets per week of legs, right, of quads. And you're responding really well. And then you go through a period of 6 months where you have a breakup and you lose your job. And now you're really stressed and you're not eating well and you're not sleeping well. 30 sets is probably now too much for you to handle. You're not going to recover as well as when you were, you know, not stressed and sleeping and eating well. So now your optimal program would look very different. I think people chase this ghost of optimal. You'll never know if you hit it. And even if you hit it, it's not going to be optimal forever.
With calisthenics, there's such a mismatch between what we actually do and what the science says. We know elite athletes that are doing literally hundreds of sets a week for an exercise targeting a muscle, when the science says on average 10 to 20 sets is going to be great for most people as a basis. What's with the discrepancy between calisthenics versus weights?
I think it's a bit of an unanswered question. And I think we don't really know what the true answer is for the upper limit of volume. So you do have some studies showing that volume more volume tends to be better. You reach a point where more volume tends to give diminishing returns. And then at a certain point, we kind of see it's detrimental, like you're training too much. But you have a lot of studies that are showing more training is better, and you know, more volume tends to just yield superior results. And then you get variation within those studies as well. So it's not like every individual, like on average, more volume is better, but you get some people who respond better to low volume, some people who respond better to high volume. I think that on average, the best athletes train higher than the research, train with higher volumes than the research would recommend. So they're just doing a lot more work. I think the skill component of calisthenics comes into that. So you have higher volumes would yield better effects with calisthenics, just because you're training more frequently and there's a higher neurological component to a lot of the exercises. There's a lot more of a skill component. So like a handstand push-up is going to take longer to master than a squat. And a lot of the exercises that are studied in the literature tend to be, you know, more stable, easier exercises like a squat or even like machine weights. So yeah, I think there is a bit of a discrepancy. But then again, it's very hard to say if what the best people are doing is better, because they're just one person. And you can't just say, hey, Andrew does 200 sets a week, therefore 200 sets a week is probably better and we should all be doing that, because we don't know the counterfactual of if Andrew did 100 sets a week or if Andrew did 50 sets a week. So yeah, I think on average, I would rather tell people to train harder rather than less. Like if someone says, hey, 30 sets is feeling pretty good, can I bump it up? I'd probably say, yeah, try it, see what happens. And often more volume is better. People think on average, people don't train hard enough. But yeah, it's very hard to say what the perfect thing is for each person.
Especially if someone's doing predominantly calisthenics, bodyweight movements, I'd argue that the fatigue per set is a lot less than doing a weighted exercise, given the ability to actually get towards failure. With these calisthenic skills, there's a lot of movement, balance, body coordination, and true muscular failure isn't often the actual limiting factor. So there's that somewhat inverse relationship between that lower relative intensity because you're doing it with your body weight versus external loads. And I'd say that it just allows you to do just more and more sets of that.
Yeah, agreed. Definitely agreed. I think that's especially true for intermediates. Yeah, but when you do look at someone like Andrew who pushes to failure, I've never seen him fall out of a handstand push-up. It's just like, it truly is failure. So it's very hard to say.
And it comes to the factor of height and weight being an influence here too, because when I compare how much I need to do being 6 foot, 85 kilos compared to a 5 foot gymnast that's 65 kilos, doing the same exercises, it's just going to be accruing more fatigue for someone that's smaller, shorter limbs, lighter body weight compared to someone that's the reverse. So I guess that's the factor that needs to be considered for these.
Yeah, I think you meant that the other way around, that the bigger guys will be accruing more fatigue. So.
Would I say the smaller guys?
Yeah.
Incorrect. Shame on me. So there's a point of diminishing returns for this quote unquote junk volume. What does that actually look like, and how can we tell when we're getting into that territory of junk volume?
So junk volume is just adding more sets without getting a benefit to it. So it's very hard to know when you're getting into this kind of realm of junk volume. Because as I said earlier, it's hard to know what it's hard to know what optimal is. It's hard to know how much progress you can potentially make. And it's hard to know what your perfect number of sets is per week. But what I tend to find is if you're doing high quality practice, if you're getting stronger, I wouldn't change anything. If you're getting stronger, your volume is sufficient to elicit the change. So the way I like to think of it is volume will influence the magnitude of changes that you get. So you do one set a week, you get some changes. You do two sets of that a week, you get more changes. You do three sets of that, you get more changes. And at a certain point, it plateaus, and then it might even hinder progress thereafter. you're not really trying to hit this perfect optimal zone. You know, you're not trying to hit that peak. You're just trying to hit somewhere that's effective, somewhere that's going to give you progress. So what I would do is I would just start with the kind of generic recommendations. And I tend to push that a little bit higher, like 10 to 30 sets per muscle group per week. For calisthenics, to make that simple, just think of it as like 10 to 30 sets of push, 10 to 30 sets of pull per week. Just start there. If you're a beginner, you can probably get away with really low volumes, like 10, and see how you go. And if you're progressing well, great, keep doing what you're doing. If you're progressing well and you feel like you can tolerate more, I feel fresh, it feels easy, I want to do more volume. I feel like I can train more and train harder. There's some left in the tank at the end of each session. Add more volume and see if you progress a little bit faster, slower, or you enjoy it more. If you are doing a lot of volume, you always feel run down. Your training kind of sucks. You just feel fatigued and you don't have any motivation. Try and reduce that volume. So volume's something that it's very hard to hit the sweet spot. It's going to be dependent on other things like failure. So maybe I can tolerate 20 sets to failure a week, but if I did 20 sets of squats to failure a week, it's a lot of squats. But if I stopped 4 reps of failure on every set, I could probably double that, triple that. It's much less fatiguing. So junk volume is basically adding on more training without giving you a beneficial effect. It's very hard to know when you are doing junk volume. But as a general rule, if you're making progress, nothing needs to change. If you're feeling good, you can try and just titrate that up a little bit. If you're feeling bad, overtrained, joints hurt, bring it down a little bit. You can also just adjust the proximity to failure. Just keep your training the same and just stop two reps further from failure. See how that feels.
Especially with volume as it relates to just purely sets, keeping that relatively constant is a great way of simplification and keeping yourself accountable, because I find a temptation that I have, just say I'm trying to progress over 8 weeks, adding more sets towards the end has an influence on my intensity, and it's hard to understand and know if I'm actually progressing. And I find that by adding more sets, my intensity across the board tends to diminish because, oh no, now I've got to do 5 sets instead of 3. And it just is like a get out of jail card for actually doing the work. So I find that most people as well, if they can just not have any wiggle room with the set and just try a phase where you're just increasing pure intensity, the progression, the weight used within the rep range or hold time that you've given to yourself, the linear progress that you'll make will be so much easier to see and understand. And you'll have more sessions where you're like, I'm going to improve on my previous effort, as opposed to doing a 4th set, but then I have to drop the whole time or the reps, and it's like it gets very complicated extending it out as it relates to volume.
Yeah, I fully agree with that. The one time I think adding more volume just tends to really help is with skill stuff.
That's the difference. Yep. But for your generic like strength training, muscle building stuff, it allows it to be a lot more simplified. But give yourself that freedom to auto regulate how many sets you do with strength skills, for sure.
Yeah, and get your training in order first. Like if you're not training hard, that would be the thing I would change. You know, like a lot of people think about the number of sets and but they're not training hard. They're not putting in effort. They're not trying to progress. They're not doing something challenging. If you are just challenging yourself frequently, consistently over time, you should get better.
Yeah, and I've noticed the less exercises per session, the more effort people can put into what they're actually doing. You get someone doing, say, 3 compound exercises for pushing compared to someone that has to do 5 or 6. The tenacity that you can put into 3 sets, 3 exercises versus 6 exercises is completely night and day. And it teaches that effort, because it's not such an overwhelming thing. Oh, I've got this massive 1.5, 2-hour workout. No, I've got these 3 exercises and I'm going to give it my all and keep progressing.
Yeah, definitely.
I've heard of something called muscle memory, and this is of interest because whenever we stop doing training, we understand that we're going to get a little bit weaker If we don't train for long enough, we'll lose some muscle mass. What is muscle memory and how does it relate to strength and muscle?
Yeah, so muscle memory is what people refer to when you train to achieve a stimulus. You train to achieve an outcome. Let's say you train to get strong and then you stop training. And when you start training again, let's say you stop training, you lose everything. When you start training again, it comes back way quicker than when you first got it. That's what people refer to with muscle memory. So let's say it took you, 5 years to go from bench pressing the bar to bench pressing 100 kilos, and then you stop, you get injured, and you can only bench press the bar again, and then it only takes you 6 months to get back to 100 kilos. How does this happen? Like, you know, or you can apply the same thing to structural changes, like how much muscle mass you have. So you often see people get really big. They get injured, you lose all of your muscle, but because you were big once before, you start training again, it just comes back and it's like, this is crazy. How did he grow so much muscle so quickly? And the reason for that, there are a few reasons for that. The first reason is that you just practice the skill. You got the neurological changes. So you, when you started bench pressing, you were sloppy, you had a hard time recruiting your muscles properly, and you learned that skill. You learned to recruit them more efficiently, recruit them more effectively. And now when you train that, you know, like riding a bike, you don't lose it. Might get a bit rusty, but you've always got that skill. When you come back to it, you can recruit those muscles more efficiently. You can apply a better stimulus to them and get them back quicker. But that doesn't seem to be the only reason. Because there are also structural changes that happen inside your muscles that provide this memory effect and allow them to grow more quickly when a stimulus is applied another time. So your muscles don't actually remember. Your muscles aren't little brains that, you know, remember what happened. However, there are changes on a structural level that occur. So you get epigenetic changes. So inside your muscles, your muscles become more efficient at signaling for your signaling proteins to grow muscle. So you get changes that happen on a structural level that make it more efficient at growing in the future. You also get more what they call myonuclei. So you get you have nuclei that basically program a cell to do things. You get more myonuclei when you train. So your muscle gets bigger and you get more nuclei in there. And then when you stop training, you retain some of them. So it's not, doesn't seem to be like permanent that all of them are retained, but you retain them at a greater rate than your muscles shrink. So when you train again, you have more nuclei there that are signaling the muscle to grow and it grows more efficiently. So there are a few changes that happen within your muscle that allow it to grow quicker when a stimulus is applied the next time. So that's some brief physiology behind it, but the practical take home is that when you train, it takes a long time to get something. When you detrain, you might lose it, but when you start training again, you'll get it back much quicker. So if you're suffering from an injury, a period of time off, don't stress, things will come back quicker. And if possible, let's say you're not injured, if you're injured, you can't train at all, you're in a sling or something, then sure, you can't train, just rest assured things will come back quicker. If you have a period of, you know, exams or work or something's really stressful and you can't dedicate as much time to training, just know that it takes way less to maintain your adaptations than it does to achieve them in the first place. So you can probably get away with doing like a ninth or a tenth of what you normally do and maintain. Let's say it took you 10, took you like 10 sessions a week of training to make a bit of progress. If you just want to maintain with what you've got, you're better off doing a little bit of something rather than nothing. So you're better off doing that one session a week. Maybe that'll give you enough to hold on to your gains.
It's really great understanding that hard work pays off. Even if you stop, you've got those dormant pathways that have been laid down. I like to think of it like a dormant volcano. The structure's been there. It just needs to be re-educated to be able to function again, or it's like a cabling through your neural system that has been laid down, but the efficiency of that through returning to your exercises will come back. And same thing relaying to the muscle with the myonuclei. It's really awesome knowing that with a bit of work, you can come back and do it again. What's not spoken enough about fitness is this idea of maintenance. It's always all or nothing. I'm training 5 days a week, and then for whatever happens, I get slightly off my path or my routine. I do nothing at all. Why is this idea of maintenance not sexy or not discussed in fitness? Like, you never see someone that's like, yeah, man, I've gone through some hard times. Work's getting pretty busy. My wife is about to give birth. I'm stressed. The bills are late. So I'm just going to do nothing. Instead of, I'm just going to do a tenth of my workout to maintain.
Yeah, I think it's like the searching for the optimal program, or searching for this one weird trick to achieve everything. There are a lot more people who are trying to achieve calisthenics skills rather than trying to maintain what they've got. People are always pushing for growth, and influences kind of, you know, feed into that. But there are a great number of people that just want to maintain what they've got through a period of stress. And it's good to know that it's very easy to maintain things relative to making progress.
It's an important discussion to have, because if you've been training, say, 5+ years, the idea of maintaining certain things or just maintenance across the board should be a discussion that we're having more of, because once you get to an advanced level, the rate of progress that you make for the amount of effort that's required to increase your full planche from 5 seconds to 8 or 10 seconds is astronomical compared to trying to get there. And it's just something that should be spoken about a bit more, in my opinion.
Yeah, agreed.
And that's relevant to us, and I'm sure many listeners that are getting older, that have been training for a long time, entering their 30s like we are. How does the mindset shift / physical practice in line with longevity, training for a long time and feeling good in your body?
Yeah, I think goals just changed. Like, when I was 18, I was like, I just want to do the hardest skills. I don't care what happens in 10 years. You know, I just want to see what my body can do. And that was like the primary care in my life. But as you get older, you have more responsibility. Your priorities change. You have kids. You have to work more. Things change. And this might just be a hobby. This might go from something that that is now just a pathway to maintaining health. You might do it for social reasons. So yeah, things definitely change in life. And I certainly have a different mindset now than I did, 15 years ago. Now it's mostly training for health, for fun. I'm not really trying to push the limits of my body. Certain skills that I could do 10 years ago will hurt if I try them now. So I don't. But yeah, you train for different reasons.
For sure. And some practical things that I've considered in light of longevity is just slightly adjusting things, as in you're going to failure less often. You're using a more joint-friendly technique with, say, a slow eccentric, a pause at the bottom, using a more moderate intensity across the board in terms of when doing isometrics, more often doing your 10 to 20 second holds. If you're doing your strength stuff, more sparingly using that 3 to 5 rep range and biasing more moderate to higher reps has been really helpful. And just at large, just choosing exercises that suit your body. So for myself, I'd always try and force a barbell squat, because the internet said if you're not doing squats, you might as well exit the gym because you're a pussy. Whereas on leg day, if my goal is to stimulate my muscles, I'm going to now choose machines or exercise that suit my structure, that don't beat up my joints, that don't give me low back pain, and hit the muscles. So this shift in mindset needs to be individual, and it's something that evolves over time as you age and your goals change too.
Yeah. And just keep training fun, just
great.
Like, I think there's this mindset online that like you have to grind and things need to be miserable, and if you're not like bleeding at the end of your session, you're a pussy. But you can train in an environment that is positive with friends, for maintaining health without the goal of squatting triple your body weight, and thrive with that for a lot longer than, you know, doing something that's miserable. So I think just try to reduce friction between you know, what you're doing now and where you want to be.
It comes back to that idea of optimal. Yeah, you could get the fastest progress or the highest magnitude of progress doing a certain approach, but if it makes you miserable doing it, what the hell's the point? And that's what I've seen from you, Simon, training alongside you over the years. It's you are the strongest person who has a structure but isn't attached to it and is really pliable with what they do, really intelligently using an intuitive approach to your training, getting great results. But as you just said, it doesn't seem like a chore to you and you're not overly attached to certain things. It's what motivates me to integrate that more into my practice. And it's been really refreshing because often it's the prisoner is yourself for that imposed situation, because you're not, if you're not competing, you're not married to a certain idea. It can be what is most enjoyable. So thanks for that.
Yeah, I think on that note, especially for the guys who've just been doing this for a little bit of time, you know, we've obviously been doing this for a really long time. And I've seen so many talented people come and go, like so many people who achieved so much in, you know, 6 months, like, and would be way stronger than I would be if they stuck at it, and they just fall off. And the people who I like look around and I see now, and like the household names in calisthenics, they're just people that they're not necessarily the most talented people. They're just people who stuck at it. You know, they're people who just kept at it for 10 years, for 20 years. And I think that's really rare. So if you can find a way to enjoy something enough to stick at it for 20 years, chances are you'll get pretty good at it.
Fantastic, Simon. If people want to check out more of your work and learn what you got to offer, where can they find you, man?
Most of my programs are on Baseblocks. So you can go to Baseblocks Plus, or you can go to my website, simonsterstrength.com.
Appreciate it, man. Till next time.
Yeah, good to speak to you.